Are you looking for a lighthouse to give you some stability and comfort in these tumultuous markets that we're having? Well, you've come to the right place. Join us tonight for the Master of Money program, where we are going to talk about volatility in the markets. We're going to look at the arguments made by the permabears and how they put the negative into the world. And we're going to show you how you don't have to succumb to fear, uncertainty, and doubt. So join me for tonight's Master of Money program. This edition of the Master of Money program is brought to you by Harvest Investment Services, a registered investment advisor where they harvest gains and minimize losses. Visit them at harvestinvestmentservices.com. And by Superstock Investor, empowering individual investors with professional research, superstockinvestor.com. And by the support of the Society to Advance Financial Education, a not-for-profit organization promoting financial education to all people. Visit them at safefinancial.org. Welcome back to this edition of the Master of Money Show. I'm Steve Beeman, your host. What a week we've had. Enough volatility in the markets to make anybody seasick. And if that's not enough, we've got China going down the path of, well, currency wars. Not a fun time to be an investor, but times that we need to stand together and learn how to manage this volatility. Now, I will tell you that this reminds me very much of 2011, in which I was interviewed virtually every day 1 week in August about volatility in the markets. And you know my message then and my message today? Stay calm. Things will be okay. The fact of the matter is back then we look and the markets, even though they were tumultuous, by the end of the week they had ended right where they started. There was no reason at all to panic in the middle. Well, today, on this episode, we're going to look at the reasons for this volatility, and we're going to talk about the arguments made by the permabears, those people who sell fear, uncertainty, and doubt to you to move their books, their newsletters, and sometimes get you to put your money with them. The fact of the matter is, most of the time they're wrong, but like a broken clock, every now and again they hit the right recipe. So stick around for the whole program. We want you to hear this message in the second half. As we go through tonight, we are going to have our friend Jeff Garbaz join us with the Superstock Minute, and we're going to talk about that market crash indicator and see exactly what it's saying today. That should give you some good practical insights. But first, as we get going, let's begin with our rubber meets the road moment. What was the most important news to you last week? What was that one item where rubber really met the road? Well, there's a lot to choose from. We have the situation in North and South Korea that could have led to a hot war. We, of course, still have the political things going on with Trump pulling very big crowds. And the Hillary scandals, well, they just seem to not to go away for her. We have the rest of the pack just filling in this extra space in the news items. But the rubber meet the road moment, what was that one item we thought was critical to you and how you live your life? It, of course, had to be the meltdown we had in the market on Monday. The markets opened that day down around 1,000 points, which had all of the news media screaming, run for the hills, this is the end. Well, when it ended the day, it was down a few hundred points, which equaled, by the way, only about 4 percentage points. Now, 4% is never fun to lose, but I think you and I can live with that in the scope of the gains that we've had over the last many years. Now, there are lots of reasons behind this volatility, and in the second half of the program today, we're going to discuss those. I'm going to go through some of the rationale used by these permabears, the people who want to scare you like Dr. Mark Faber or even a Peter Schiff, both of whom I have great respect for, but when they come out only looking at the bad, well, it would make anybody go buy gold, put it under their mattress, and just be gone. Well, we don't want you to do that here at the Master of Money. We want you to learn how to be the pilot in control of your own ship. So we're going to talk in the second half about what's causing this volatility, what the fears are, and how you can mitigate those. Now, I will touch on one news item that didn't exactly meet the rubber meets the road quality. It turns out that our latest, star? Yes, Caitlyn Jenner is going to be charged with manslaughter charges for the accident that he had back in the spring. Now, some of you may be offended by the fact that I called Caitlyn a he, but if we go back to when the accident happened, she was a he. Oh, well, what do you do about that? The rubber certainly doesn't meet the road on that kind of salacious entertainment. But where it does meet the road, let's begin to go there right now. Let's take a look at the geopolitical things going on around the world that do ultimately affect you. The biggest geopolitical news was this issue between North and South Korea. We have a situation there in which the North Koreans blew up a landmine that injured a South Korean soldier and refused to take accountability for it. Well, in response, the South for many years has been blasting propaganda across the demilitarized zone into the North. Well, as a result of these accelerated incidents, we almost had a hot war over there. The North scrambled 30 of their subs, which is about all of their submarine fleet. In fact, the United States was concerned because we didn't know where they went. But in addition to this, they had threatened to launch missiles against the South. Well, this is not a good situation. For those of you who need a little military history lesson, let's remember that when they settled their differences in the 1950s, they didn't sign a treaty. They're simply on a hiatus from the hot war. It's a truce, and that is not exactly strong enough to prevent that hot or that cold war from going hot. So it's very important. We've got the Chinese behind the North Koreans and the Americans behind the South Koreans, and we want to keep an eye on that beleaguered peninsula. We don't want a hot war there by any stretch, and we hope cooler minds always will prevail. And in this case, it does look like the North and South Koreans came to an agreement. Secondly, I want to talk about China. You've heard a lot about it as this market volatility has grown, and you've heard about China devaluing their currencies and China going into possible recession, if not depression. Well, the reality is the Chinese are following an oft-followed route that never works well. They're devaluing their currency in order to get growth back in their economy. This has never worked well for countries. In fact, it reminds me a little bit of the 1930s when the United States and all of the countries around the world began with currency wars into tariff wars. Well, we all know how that ended, and I fear for the Chinese, this won't end much better. You do not build an economy by weakening your currency. Yes, in theory, it helps your exports and hurts your imports. However, for the Chinese, I think they're going to find all this does is slow down global trade. That is not going to make anyone happy, and that's one of the reasons the markets have been reacting so poorly. So to China, I would simply share a message of history. Rethink that strategy. It's not going to work well for anyone. And finally, we've talked about this again, but oil prices come up. With the slowing down economies, oil has slipped below that magic $40 a barrel marker. The importance of that, of course, is below $40, fracking doesn't make any sense, so you may see a little bit slowdown in capacity with the fracking services. But more than that, at below $40, Russia, Venezuela, and the Mideast all are going to be experiencing significantly chaotic economies. This is not necessarily good. We have Putin in Moscow making very aggressive statements about his desire to get the Ukraine back and even Finland. So we're going to have to see how it plays out. By the way, I've had a question that's come up from a lot of people who talk with me, and they've said, if oil prices have come down so much, why aren't gas prices coming down? Well, the answer there lies in regulations. We have so regulated this economy that now it's not worth the capital for a person to put up a refinery. So while we have ample oil supplies and very low oil prices, we don't have the refining capacity to get the gas prices down. Well, that's not a short-term solution. So while gas won't be going up badly anytime soon, I don't think we're going to see $1 a gallon gas for a long, long time. Now, as we move from the top, the geopolitical, down into the economic, the most important thing last week that you should be aware of is that the Federal Reserve did have its monthly meeting. They came out of that meeting hypothesizing as to whether or not, with everything going on, they can afford to raise interest rates. And we all know they want to. They've talked about it, raising them by maybe 25 basis points in September and another 25 basis points in December. The problem is strengthening the U.S. dollar into an environment where everyone else is devaluing their dollar or weakening their currency. Well, that's not going to help the U.S. economy. We rely on exports to some extent in the United States, and the stronger our dollar, the weaker our exports. Now, in the long run, a strong dollar is what builds a strong economy. It puts value in capital formation, and has a number of other benefits. But in the near term, strengthening the dollar too much in an economy like this could put us right back into recession. Bear in mind, we're only looking at about a 2, maybe 2.5% growth rate as it is. Secondly, the Congressional Budget Office cut their annual forecast for the United States from 2.9% growth to 2%. Now, seriously, if anybody has been watching this program or if you've joined me for any of these, you know we're not growing anywhere near 3%. The fact is we're going to be lucky to squeeze out 2.2% this year. They came out and revised it because of what's going on in China and therefore our export markets. But the reality is the United States economy is sputtering along. As we've discussed so often, there for every bit of good news, there's a bit of bad news. This economy can't seem to make up its mind. We are seeing some job growth, but it's at the very low end. We're also seeing automation come in at the very low end and eliminate jobs like fast food jobs. So we're in a tumultuous economy. And so for them to come out and say, well, gee, maybe we're only going to grow at 2%. Seriously, guys, you should watch the Master of Money program. And as it relates to that, let me give you some truly bipolar data. In June, the Schiller Price Index for homes came out and said that in the United States, home prices had leveled out. In other words, they'd been rising a bit, which is good, and they leveled out, indicating a slowdown in the marketplace. So most economic models, most GDP forecasts would say, well, housing's slowing down. Well, here comes July when new home sales shot back up. Once again, it's an indication the U.S. economy can't quite get its head on straight. For every time there's something good, there's something bad. And let me give you a more interesting one. We've talked about the Consumer Confidence Index in the past, and in the month of August, the Consumer Confidence Index jumped way up. But that was before $1.8 trillion was taken out of the economy in the last few days. So we'll see exactly how consumer confidence holds up in the face of a tumultuous marketplace. Moving, as we do, from the economic down into the financial, boy, what a ride. I can see, you know, there's a perspective for you that I want you to have. In fact, I'm going to put up here a chart that shows the level of decline in the markets that we had this time versus other times historically in the market. And you can see the decline we had on Monday at a 4% drawdown was nowhere near record territory. So I don't think we need to be overly concerned about it. And I wanted to bring one other point up with that. One of the followers of the Master of Money last night and I spoke, and he said, Steve, I'm curious. When I flipped on the morning news, everybody was screaming about this 1,000-point drop in the Dow. But with the Dow at 16,000, isn't that not necessarily as big a deal it was as when the Dow was at, say, 8,000? Well, that's a great point. And, you know, it's not one I often think of because I think in terms of percentages, but it's the percentage moves you want to look at in these markets, not the absolute point moves. To get a 300-point down day sounds scary to everybody. Well, that's a couple of percent. It's not that significant. So when the news media and the politicians and some of the perma-bears come out and throw out these big numbers and say, oh, my Lord, run for the hills. The market's down 500 points. You, as a master of money, well, you need to be a little more calm and say, yeah, but that's only a couple percentage points. We can live in that space. So that chart shows you that we're not near record territories for drawdowns. I'm not suggesting we won't have those in the future. I think we will. And that's why you put on risk controls. But this one, nothing to write home about. Secondly, in the second half of the show, as I've said, we're going to talk about the details of this volatility. What's causing it? Why is it there? It's not that much rocket science. It's a lot of common sense. But it's stuff you can build into your investments so that you know you're not taking risks that you're not aware of. And managing a portfolio is all about managing risk. So you want to definitely stay tuned for that part. And then finally, as I said, with consumer confidence spiking up in August, and we mentioned this in the economic side, but it's true in the financial side too, and that $1.8 trillion coming out of the wealth of the American consumer, we're going to have to see what happens in retail sales over the next few weeks. Specifically, I'll be looking at auto sales, which had been strengthening nicely, home sales, and the larger tickets. We'll see if people are afraid of this market or, well, if it really hasn't done that much to them. I suspect, much like 2011, at the end of this, when it all shakes out, neither the markets nor the consumers are going to be much different than they were at the beginning of it. So now we're down to the ground level, of course, a place where the rubber absolutely meets the road with that, well, what do I do moment? And for that, we're going to join our friend Jeff Garbaz for the Superstock Minute and let Jeff update us on our market crash portfolio. With all that's gone on in the markets these last few days, I'm anxious to see what that portfolio recommends. Here's Jeff.
Hey, Steve. It's great to see you. Thanks for having me back. It's been a pretty tough week in the last week or so since we last talked. The market has fallen precipitously since we did our last video. The S&P had closed at 2096, and when we were talking last, we were on the verge of a potential breakout or breakdown. We thought we didn't know which way it would go, but now we know the answer to the question. We have broken to the downside in a pretty big way. Started off last Wednesday, we lost about 83 basis points, and since that day, every day we've lost more than 1%. And this evening, we sit at a whopping 18,067.61. So, been a pretty big drop. Market crash indicators came into the week 75% invested, so we're able to withstand about 25% of the down. We're now outperforming for the year. It's definitely been a tough period, probably one of the toughest periods I've seen for such a quick drop. And we're either going to hold out here and start working our way back higher, or we've got more downside. As such, we've moved to 50% invested. We had a pretty good drop this last week. I'm kind of pulling up the numbers right here, going down to take a look at them. The S&P last week lost 10.94%, and SPY lost 10.10%. So under our process, where we're 75% invested, going down to kind of pull this up, we lost about 8 and change under that process. But under our SPY, we lost 10.10%. So one of the bigger drawdowns, and as such this week with some of the deterioration we've seen, we've now moved to P-Hedge, which means we're 50% invested, and P-Hedge lost 3% last week. So if we start to get an upside bounce, we'll almost get as much upside by being in P-Hedge as being in SPY. This is definitely a big outlier. Our scores, we talked a little last week about the Madison, are now between minus 24 and minus 26. We actually came into the day with even lower scores, rebounded, and then in the last hour, the market kind of gave up the ghost here. So we'll have to see where things go from tomorrow. But we've been down 6 days in a row now, and the likelihood is that maybe we get one more down day. We've seen down 7 days in a row about 2 times since the end of 2008, when we moved into 2009, started moving higher. So we were really at extremes. Even a bounce that could take us probably, I mean, today we were at 1940 before we finished at 1867. So we're just having an incredible amount of intraday volatility, and there's simply no way that it can continue. And we really feel that it's probably playing itself out here. And from here, we should start to move back up to some level, and then we'll see what happens when we get to that particular level. So 50% invested from 75%. Still dramatic outperformance since we've started the model, and we'll be shooting that out to you. And anyone who has an interest, you know, can get in touch with you to get a copy of it for each week until we get it put into the weekly newsletter as we move forward. So that's all that we got to report now. It's definitely been a tough week, and we've seen weeks like this before. We feel there's a good chance for a recovery. One thing we heard that was interesting is former analyst at J.P. Morgan, who looks at some statistics as well, found that when you go down 3 days in a row and you lose 9%, which we've done within this period, often you get a counter rally that goes up 7%, so that leaves you down 2%, and we're hoping that could play out. The other scenario is that if we were down 10%, you typically lose another 3% in the 28 corrections that we've seen since the 1930s. And on average, it takes 1.4 times to go back up. This correction unfolded over 35 days, so we're looking at 50 days. If that's the case, we're going to be back to new highs by October. It seems implausible that that could occur right now, but that is definitely what statistics tell us. And our model through time, we don't stay down at these levels for extended periods of time. Even as we've had the experience of 2007, 2008, and 2011. So that's it for now. No great news. We were not 100% invested, and that's all we got to report.
Welcome back. I once again want to thank everyone who has written to me or commented about the reformat of the show and the adding of the Super Stock Minute or the Rubber Meets the Road segment. We've really had some good feedback, and I welcome you to write me at steve@themasterofmoneyshow.com anytime with your thoughts, suggestions, and ideas on how we make this a more impactful program for you. Remember, we do this for you. It is all about you, and it's all about helping you build the wealth and prosperity that you deserve. So write me anytime with questions and observations. Now, as I said, we're going to change up this second segment just a little bit. Normally, here in the second half, I try to give you a topic of interest, whether I'm writing about exchange-traded funds or how to put risk controls into your portfolio or annuities and how they can help. Well, this time, I'm going to give you a little bit of an economics lesson. We're going to talk about the drivers behind this market and help you eliminate some of the fear, uncertainty, and doubt and confusion that's being thrown at you from all of the 24/7 media cycles. We want you to be in control of this. Now, as we go through this stormy sea, let's take a look at what's really driving it. Now, I've spoken with you about permabears, those investment professionals who look only at the negative and say the sky is falling. Well, no different than the perma bulls who tell you it's always rosy and wonderful. Well, these people usually have an agenda. They're out to sell you a newsletter or a book or something else based on fear and uncertainty. This isn't the way to manage your money. It's not the way to control your investments and build your wealth. Fear does not work. But I will tell you, as I said, naive optimism doesn't either. I'll share with you, I have written some 400 articles on better living, a little 450 or so. Most of them, or many of them, have to do with finance and why people's path to prosperity is so often disrupted by their lack of financial knowledge. Well, there are several key components contained within those that I've written about, and I want to share one of them with you right now. What I call this in an article I wrote, Lessons from the Cockpit. For those of you who know me, you know that I'm a private pilot. And as a pilot, you learn several things, but one of the things you learn is never to trust your gut. Always trust your instruments. And let me share with you a personal story. One night I was flying back to Chicago, my home airport of DuPage Airport, from Cincinnati, Ohio. I left there about 11 o'clock at night, so by 1 in the morning, I was just dead center over Northwest Indiana, little bit south of the Crown Point area where there isn't a light to be seen. Now, this was before all those great big windmills went up that light up the sky. So when I looked out my windows, I saw pitch black. The ground, the horizon, the sky, pitch black. In other words, you visually had absolutely no sense of what direction you were, what pitch you were on, what role you had. Well, as my center of gravity had adjusted, as I flew along, I thought for sure I'm straight and level flight. Well, what do you know? I looked at my instrumentation and it said, no, I wasn't straight and level. I was in a descending left bank. Now, I couldn't feel it. I certainly couldn't see it. But I learned I trust my instruments. So I righted up the ship, so to speak, and I ended up flying home safely. Had I not followed the instruments, problems would have ensued. And I will tell you that same lesson holds true for you managing your wealth. Don't follow the emotional fear, greed, and doubt syndrome. Follow your instruments. Look at the data. Look at the logic. Look at what you know is happening, not what you wish would happen. I can't stress enough how many people I've seen lose money because they were too optimistic about an investment. And when we get to know each other better sometime, I'll share with you why I became a financial guy in my early, early days. I was one of those who got caught up in irrational exuberance. But I think it's important for you to know as you go through these tumultuous seas, you got to keep a strong head on. You don't let your emotions get the best of you. Now, as we go down and we look at this, on Monday, we had this whopping 1,000-point sell-off. As we came back through the day, it was coming back, but it ended up down several hundred points. Again, a drop of about 4%. Nothing to, you know, laugh at. None of us like to lose money, but certainly not a reason to run for the hills. We don't see that kind of problem there. I think you and I and most people can handle a 4% loss. But that night, and this was last night, so Tuesday night, I had an interview with Peter Schiff, or with him on an interview panel. I've got that up on the website, so if you ever go to themasterofmoneyshow.com, you can see that interview. But Peter is one of these perma bears. Peter always sees the negative. He sees why the markets are going to crash. And, you know, I can't argue with a lot of what he says. I have great respect for him. But had you listened in 2009 to the perma bears, you would have missed a run from 7,000 up to where we are today, a 230% gain. So we want to look through the fear, uncertainty, and doubt proffered by many of these people and look to the reality. Let's look at their arguments one by one. First thing they will tell you is that this market has gone from 7,000 to its current 16,000 based on two things. Number one, the Federal Reserve. Yes, the quantitative easing done by the Federal Reserve, which pumped liquidity into the markets, is part of the reason that the U.S. stock market has grown. There's no argument about that. The second thing is what's called ZIRP. How's that for an acronym? The Zero Interest Rate Policy of the Fed. Now, that's another policy that has made bonds uncompetitive with stocks. So when you put this quantitative easing together with the zero interest rate policy, you get a rising market. And they're not incorrect. That indeed has kept the U.S. market up, as bonds have stayed largely flat, if not gone down a little bit. Now, the argument that because they necessarily can't do that again, and their argument would say you can't do a QE4 and you can't take interest rates below zero, therefore, there's nothing to hold up the market. Well, in a world where a vacuum exists and those are the only two things that drive stock prices, I would agree with them. But those aren't the only two things that drive stock prices. We'll look at a few of those just down the road. Now, the second thing they will argue with you is debt. Debt, debt, and debt. And let me tell you, in my public seminars, I'm the first one to say debt must be settled. I'm not a big fan of overloaded debt. But the key word there is overloaded. Their argument is that the federal, the state, the consumer, the business debt is so egregious that we're going to have a collapsing dollar and bread's going to cost $1 million a loaf. Well, as I said last week, I don't think that's the case at all. The debt levels we had do shave off of our growth rates. There's no question about that. You cannot build an economy on debt. When you pay debt back, it's a non-productive use of cash. But we do not yet have a debt level that most people would think is going to cause a collapse. Relative to other nations, relative to the size of our economy, relative to the potential growth that exists, the asset base that we hold, our debt's problematic, but I don't think it's at a cataclysmic level yet. You and I will have to monitor that over the next years to make a determination really on when that will happen. I mean, the fact of the matter is debt and all of that is affecting our lifestyles because it's cutting our growth rate, but it's not going to crush us. The third thing is that the changes in the economy, the globalization that's taking place, the technology changes, robotics that are costing jobs, are costing productivity, are becoming debilitating to the middle class. And therefore, well, game, set, and match. The economy's dead. The market's dead because of debt. The Fed can't stimulate. Run for the hills, buy gold, and go short the market. Well, the reality is, yes, we're in a changing economy. We've talked about that here on The Master of Money. Technology is on the low end of jobs replacing people with robotics. You cannot change that. It's a reality. But also thrown into that equation is the development of advanced manufacturing, robotics, 3D printing, new material sciences like graphene. Imagine with me for just a minute a world in which we can irrigate the Sahara Desert to grow crops. Some of these new materials that are coming online today give us that capability. The biggest argument for economic growth is that 90% of the world lives below our middle income level. Well, if we can bring those people up to an American way of life and an American standard of living, that's enough growth to fuel corporate earnings for the next 100 years. I believe we can do it. Are we going to have some dislocation in the economy? You betcha, just like they did when we went through industrialization. But is this the end? Nah. Stay true to what you believe. When you're looking at your investments, there's a reason you bought them. Unless that reason has changed, don't just sell them because everybody else is running for the hills. This is not a game of follow the leader. It is a game of letting your wits outsmart everybody else. The bottom line of all of it, investing never is, never has been, and never will be easy. It takes a lot of knowledge, a great deal of discipline, and a lot of faith in your understanding of your instruments. You don't want to get caught as a pilot who's following their gut. You also don't want to buy into the arguments of the permabears or the permabulls who give you all the negative or all the positive. You have to make your own arguments, not being one of the crowd. You've got to become a master of money so that you know what's driving stock prices up and what's driving the investments you hold. That's why this program exists, and it's why the master of money exists for you. Well, folks, I could go all night on it, but the fact is, when it comes down to it, there's a lot to teach, a lot to learn, and together, we're going to walk down a journey to your path to prosperity and help you get there. We're going to teach you how to mitigate those risks and avoid those potholes that line the way. That is the purpose of the Master of Money. Well, that's my show for today. When we come back next week, we'll have more, and hopefully this market will settle down, so we'll have less volatility to talk about. But until then, have a happy and prosperous week. And don't forget, when you're making those important decisions, don't look to the shiny object that the news media is flashing at you. Make sure that you make your decisions where the rubber meets the road.